Lakewood, young adults, are y'all ready tonight? Let me try it one more time. Lakewood, young adults, are y'all ready tonight? Hey, listen. So I'm in H-Town. Now, this is only the second time I've been in Houston, and both times have been to Lakewood Church. So tonight, I'm home. Now, some of y'all don't know what that means, but I'm about to be me tonight. And we're about to see God's glory meet us in this place right now. So if you have an expectation, let's give God a shout of praise before anything happens. Come on, let's give him the glory that he is worthy of. Hey, high five three people and say, tonight is for me. Come on, just find three people, tell them, tonight is for me. I'm glad you came, but tonight is for me. You can take your seats. Man, I am so excited to be here tonight, and y'all came on out tonight, and I feel like something special is gonna happen because people came in here with expectation. Before I get started with anything, I gotta say to the leaders of this movement here at the Young Adults Ministry, Pastor Nick and Summer, I wanna thank you for your leadership, for your friendship. Nobody does anything for 9 years unless God's told them that there was something in it. And you've seen thousands of people come to Christ to take further steps. And it's because of the stuff nobody else sees. It's the stuff you do behind closed doors. So can we thank God for the leaders of this young adult ministry? Can we? Oh, y'all can do better than that. Thank you. Thank you. Yeah. And I can't stand on this platform without giving a shout out to, I call him Uncle Joel now. But Pastor Joel and Victoria have blazed trails in the world. And I want to thank God. Can we thank God for the leaders of this amazing church? That's touching. Y'all can do better than that. We love you. All right. I hope you came to do some aerobics tonight. Because God changed my message on the plane. And you know, I like to be planned and I like everything to be real coordinated. But when God like interrupts my nap on the plane, that means he wants to speak something specifically to somebody who came in here tonight. And so I'm gonna try in the next, how much time do I got? What I got, okay? What? It's Friday night in Houston. All right. If you gotta go, peace. But we're going to be here for the next few minutes because I want to get something to you. Anytime I close out a conference, I've been to a lot of conferences, but I know that what happens is everybody gets hyped and then they don't know how to apply the conference tomorrow. Like many of you have had an encounter with God, God's shown you something, or you feel peace in another way because the whole conference is talking about peace being power. But I like to get these big concepts and make them real practical. Because I've been to too many things where I felt goosebumps, but I didn't change. And so today, I'm gonna be real. I'm gonna come to your house. I might get in your living room. Don't kick me out, because I'm trying to help you. Today, I wanna kind of rehearse some of the things you've already heard if you've been here, but I wanna push it into the practical today, and I believe the Holy Spirit wants to show you how to live this thing out when we talk about peace. How many people in this room could use some more peace in your life? Okay, girl over there was like, oh my God, I could use a lot more peace. Everybody could use more peace. The thing is, our idea of peace, I really think, is warped. I think before I really started following God, like I was one of those Christians who was like more of a, I do it out of the duty and it looks good. Like I go to church, but I was living any kind of way behind the scenes. Ain't none of those here, huh? Nobody amens that, but your DMs is dirty. No, come on, let's be honest, because we're in here worshiping, but go through your text message thread. My man is so straight-faced over here. The reason I can talk about it is because I lived it. And what was happening is I was searching for peace in all the wrong places. And there are so many people in our generation that we are searching for peace in all the wrong places. We're searching for peace on vacation. Because you just think if you could go on a vacation, you could find some peace. Some of us are searching for peace in a relationship, but you've had 10 and you're 20. Oh, I'm in somebody's house right now. Like, a lot of us are searching for peace in money. But the thing about money is money only magnifies who you really are. So if you're a liar, when you get money, you're just a more efficient liar. If you're insecure, when you get money, you think everybody wants your money. We don't want your money, but it just magnifies everything you are. And today, I don't know what you've been escaping to find peace, but I want to let you know that peace is only truly found in the one who created us. And his name is the Prince of Peace. And so today, I want to talk to you because I have some pictures personally of what peace looks like. To me, peace looks like a sunset on a beach. I don't know if you have a picture of this right now, but put that sunset up for me real quick. This is what peace looks like to me. Like in my natural mind, I want a beach. I want some music playing. I want my wife there in nothing. And if you like it, then you should have put a ring on it. I'm just telling you what peace is for me. Or another time for me that peace, it's like peace for me is Chick-fil-A on a Sunday. Like if I could ever get Chick-fil-A at 2 o'clock on Sunday with some waffle fries, Chick-fil-A sauce, and a large lemonade and a small cookies and cream shake. Everybody say peace. But what I found out, I know many of you have seen this picture before, but for all those who didn't, I want you to get this image etched in your mind. I think this is what peace looks like more accurately. Will you put that picture up? Now, many of you have seen this picture and you're like, Pastor Mike, why would you show me a picture of raging water and all of this stuff going around? Right in the middle of this picture, there is a little bird who is now, I want you to think about it though. This bird flew there knowing all that was going on around it, but for some reason has found there to be safety in the midst of a storm. Real peace is when God allows you to go back to that job, into that house, into those situations that have raging water and storms all around it, and you chilling. Because you know who created the water. And many of you, you never find peace because peace to you is there being nothing around you that's going wrong. And what I found out is that God is the one that walks into situations that are jacked up, and he provides a level of calm, assurance, and a level of knowing that no matter what's going on around me, there is a God who is standing with me and will provide. Everybody shout at me, peace. So tonight, if you're taking notes, the title of tonight's message is Peace Under Pressure. Because a lot of y'all are experiencing pressure and you want tranquility and you want there to be some type of calm. But God says, what if I don't slow the storm down? Will you still be able to have peace? Yeah, because I know you want pastor to pray for you, and then once he prays for me, everything's gonna go away. I'm so sorry. that on Monday, that person that gets on your nerves at work still gonna be there. And I'm so sorry, but Houston traffic is not gonna change because of your prayer life. But how do I navigate as a believer and keep my peace when my kids are on my last nerve? Some of y'all don't know where the last nerve is, but it's right back here where I'm probably gonna be bald one day, like right here. I found that peace is not found in something that is external. Peace is found in someone who is internal. So today I want to walk with you, and by the end of this, I'm going to teach preach tonight, because I'm going to go to the Bible to help you with peace, because some of y'all in here want to just clap and get hype, but I want you to change. Because anytime you talk about peace, stuff is going to happen to get on your nerves. Can I tell you my story today? Today, I woke up at 5 a.m. to come to Lakewood to preach at the Young Adult Conference. And we get to the airport, go from Tulsa to Dallas, and we stand at the gate at Dallas waiting for them to let us off the plane. And then they let us off the plane. We go to our next plane, and the woman shuts the door to our flight while looking at me. Now, it's one thing if she didn't see me. I'm sorry, you didn't see me. We are eye to eye. And I'm saying, hey, hey. And she looks at me and says, we sat there while our plane was there for another 30 minutes. And they shut the door and would not let me or my two brothers get on the plane. And I said, Holy Spirit, what are you trying to teach me? He said, I can't allow you to talk on peace if you don't have a firsthand experience. I said, maybe I should talk on joy or something. And he said, what are you going to do, Michael? I said, I'm about to go slap that woman and lay hands on her. Oh, can we be real? Is there anybody that sometimes want to lay hands on somebody and then resurrect them? She was like, I did it yesterday. But God said, I want you to find me in the middle of this situation. So as the woman was literally down there for 30 minutes, I started pacing. I was like, I don't want to do something. God said, sit down and start praying. I don't want to pray, God. He said, until you get back into me, all of this is going to make you act out of the character I've called you to. I said, okay, so I sat down. Wasn't no prayer words coming out. Can we be honest? When there's pressure and things around us, a lot of times we don't feel like doing what we know we're supposed to do. But there's something on waiting on the Lord. I sat there, I put on my worship music on my iPhone. And what ended up happening is something came out of me that was not in me naturally when I looked at the situation. It was the God in me saying, I will give you peace in the middle of this frustration. So I'm standing there when the woman walks up the bridge. She comes out, and you know, I'm expecting, I'm so sorry, sir. The woman walked past me and didn't say a thing. And I said, Lord, and the Holy Spirit said, go up and talk to her. I went up and talked to her, and I said, ma'am, she said, hand me your ticket, sir. I walked away, and I said, I'll be back when I'm better. Can I be real with you? Everything in me wanted to act out of my flesh. But God said, I have given you something on the inside of you that can make you act against how you really want to act. And when you do that, you represent me. And so look, I'm just telling you my story, and I'm going to give it to you in the way that it's going to help you. I walk back over, and Holy Spirit said, go sit down. because I wasn't ready. And sometimes the smartest thing that you can do to keep peace is not engage in certain situations when you're not ready. I wasn't ready. The crazy thing is, the whole time there was another woman watching this whole situation who had more authority than her. And she saw how we were mistreated, and she saw what was happening, and I didn't even have to say nothing. And she walked up to me with first class tickets on the next flight. Because if I hold my peace, the Lord will begin to fight your battles. And I came to tell somebody that it is time for you to find your peace. Everybody say, I found my peace. But it's not in how you want to react. It's how God has created us to find our peace in him. And this is where I want to pick up in John chapter 16, verse 33. Because if you think peace is going to be the pictures that we talked about, it's not. Jesus even says, here on this earth, you will have many trials and sorrows. You're going to have trouble. You're going to have pressure. But take heart, because I've overcome the world. Jesus, is that your pep talk for us? Like, you're going to struggle. You're not going to get everything that you want. It's not always going to be easy. See, in church, we want everybody to think it's going to be easy. And when I come to Christ, everything's going to be fine. He tells us there's going to be trouble and strife and struggle and frustrating family members. But you're still supposed to maintain peace while you're going through it. And so the disciples are like, Jesus, like, we would rather you just work miracles and do stuff like that. Why are you even telling us this? Like, I wish you wouldn't even tell us this, because I don't even want to go through this. But look at the top of verse 33. He says, the reason I told you this is so that you may have, everybody say peace.
Peace.
And look where the peace is found. It says, I want you to have peace in me. So if you're in this room, I don't care if you're in high school, I don't care if you're a CEO of a company. God's saying, is everything that you are doing to produce counterfeit peace is outside of what I've called you to do, because peace is found only in me. Now, I want you to hear me say this, because for many years, I thought peace was found in other things. I thought peace was found in other people liking me. I thought peace was found in my accolades in music. I thought peace was found in how many people follow me on Instagram. I'm telling you right now, I watched a documentary on Whitney Houston a few weeks ago. And what happened is, she sold over 300 million records. And one of the first people that came onto her documentary said, Whitney Houston did not die of a drug overdose. She died of a broken heart. Because you can have everything, but have no peace. Because what I found is, most people know how to have peace in here, but when the pressures of life hit them, we don't know how to handle what's happening. See, the pressures of life are kind of like this bar right here. Like, this is my life. And if I just had to deal with my life, like nothing else was happening, I could lift my life. It's my life. This is easy. I could do this all day. I could talk to y'all, because if it was just my issues and my problems, that would be easy. But what happens when we have things that are unexpected that come in life? I get a job where they don't pay me enough. Yep. And then I go to that church where people act holy, but they talk about you behind your back. Now, what happens when I'm sitting here trying to find and do everything God's called me to do, but now I have to lift a life that has come with sorrows and trials? We wake up day after day and we sit under the pressure of life. And let me help you. I don't care who you are. Life comes to put trial and tribulation on you. And so now I got to sit here. Oh, God. Didn't want to wake up this morning, because I have to lift the pressures of life. But I can get it up in church. Hallelujah. You have won the victory. And what we do is we put on a show and we try to lift in front of people. But what ends up happening is many of us are buckling under the pressure because we did not go to the right source to help us lift. Oh, you don't have to clap right here. I see it on your face. I see it when you're trying to. Some of y'all changed outfits 4 times tonight because you were looking for something in somebody else that you could never find. You have to only find in Christ. And see, Pastor Mike, I don't know what to do with this pressure. Neither did the disciples. In John chapter 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, Jesus is trying to prepare them. He says, hey, y'all, I'm about to go away to do something that none of y'all could do. And they're like, you're not going nowhere. I rebuke you. And Peter said that. He said, get behind me, Satan. He said, I'm about to do something none of y'all can do. And then he says, but I need y'all to come here and I'm going to wash your feet. And he bends down in humility and he washes their feet. And after he washes their feet, he says, one of y'all are going to betray me. And they was like, who's going to do that? That ain't going to be me. He was like, the one that's dipping bread in ranch right now. And Judas was like, oh my God. And then he tells him, he says, I'm about to leave y'all. And this is where the disciples walk into the same type of pressure that we walk in every day. Because the one who has been walking with them for all of this time on earth and providing for them is saying, I'm leaving you. This is the same Jesus that when the disciples were hungry, took 2 fish and 5 hush puppies and made it into a dinner for 20,000 people. I mean, he's a walking miracle-making, buffet-making God. This is the same Jesus when tax season came around and the disciples were worried. He was like, look at that fish right there. Open his mouth. The tax money's in there. Wouldn't you like a friend like that? This is the same Jesus who, no matter what place they went to, there was somebody that was like an Airbnb for them that they didn't have to pay for. Somebody was opening their barn or their house to them. He was their lifeline, and Jesus is telling them, I gotta go. And they started to feel the pressure. They started to feel the thing that you feel when you're trying to figure out how you're gonna get into school next semester. See, because it's not enough that we have to live some big pressures in our life. But what you don't understand, it's not the big pressures that make us buckle. It's the little annoyances. I broke my phone on the way to work. It's that stuff that if we're not centered in Jesus will tip us over the edge and allow us not to walk in the fullness of what God called us to do. It's that person that continues to talk about your last relationship like it's a current relationship, and they always bring in stuff up and they add little weights to your life. And what I'm supposed to do, keep serving God, keep being faithful, keep serving, but God, I do not want to lift this. I don't want to lift this anymore. And this is why people go to alcohol instead of lifting their life. This is why people go to drugs and opioids, because I'd rather medicate myself than have to live and lift this life. God, I can't see myself past this moment. See, the enemy knows that your most vulnerable position is when you're lifting life. And right now, if you wanted to attack me, I'm in my most vulnerable state. Because I'm trying to lift pressure that I'm shaking under. And most believers are sitting here trying to reach purpose with the pressures of life weighing them down. This is what you look like every day. And God said, why would you carry the weight of life on your own when I promised that I would be the one? I almost didn't make that. when I promised that I would be the one to help you lift every heavy burden. Pastor Mike, why are you teaching like this? Because I feel like there's somebody that came in here tonight who, after the conference is gone and after everybody stops jumping, that's what you're going to look like tomorrow morning. That the pressure of life is weighing on your chest. But I came to tell you that God wants to give you peace, not absence of pressure, but he wants to give you peace. Everybody say under pressure. Now that ain't sexy, but it's necessary. Pastor Mike, I just want it to go away. It's not. Somebody asked me one time, they said, does a Christian life get easier? I said, no, you get stronger. No, hear me. So now the disciples are like, what are we gonna do? Because you saying you leaving, but we can't live this life without you. I want you to write this point down. How do you have peace under pressure? You accept the advocate and use his help. Come on. See, what he tells them is that, I know, I've been with you, like Jesus in the flesh. He said, you want the person of Jesus, but what you really want is the promise that I'm making you. And the promise is that there is a greater one coming that can help you lift the pressures of life. Look at it in John chapter 16, verse 7. He said, but in fact, it is best for you that I go away. Because if I don't, the advocate won't come. If I do go away, then I will send him to you. And the advocate is the Holy Spirit. Now, I know this is not a sexy term, especially at a youth and young adult conference, but I don't need no more followers. I need you to be changed. And what you're trying to do is lift the pressures of life without the Holy Spirit. And let me help you right now, because a lot of you have heard about the Holy Spirit or the Holy Ghost, and it's a problem because it's a bad branding problem. Like, the Holy Spirit, if I was doing his PR, I would have named him something else. Because anybody, you're like, the Holy Ghost or the Holy Spirit, like, that's spooky. I would have just named him Greg. I would have just been like, I'm going to send you Greg, and he's going to come help you. Because a lot of people get turned off by the Holy Spirit. But Jesus said, it's better that I go. So you can get the Holy Spirit. Everybody just say it with me. The Holy Spirit.
The Holy Spirit.
The Holy Spirit is not an it, it's a him. It's God in another form. And what the Holy Spirit does, Jesus knew this, but the disciples didn't. That if Jesus stayed, he was only present. But if the Holy Spirit came, he would be omnipresent. So he could be in your past, he could be in your present, and he could be in your future. That's why God came to tell somebody right now, if you need peace in your life, the Holy Spirit is the only one that can be everywhere you need to be. And so when the pressures of life keep stacking up. Now, y'all saw how much I struggled with that last week. But the crazy thing about life is that it doesn't care. It doesn't care that I'm preaching to everybody around the world. Me and my wife are dealing with the situation right now that put us under pressure. See, while I'm here right now and everybody started seeing the blow up, that was the exact same time that me and my wife found out that our son, MJ, had autism. And our son is 3 and a half right now, about to be 4, never spoken a word. And if life could pass anybody, I'm out here, God, preaching to everybody else. I'm trying to get everybody else to know you. Why would you put this level of pressure on me and my wife? Why would you allow the one thing that we love more than anything to have a disability and we can't even help him with it except love him right now and pray and believe God for a miracle? He said, because the pressures of life aren't biased. What's happening in your home is happening in my home too. And it may be different, But over this past year and a half, it's been hard for me to sit down at the bar of life and even want to lift it. In front of everybody at Lakewood Church, this should be the most amazing season of my life. But I'd give everything up to hear my son say, "Dada." And you think because I speak in faith and I help other people that maybe life would be a little easier for me? He said, "I bring life to everybody, not to break them, but to make them." And so over this, I want you to hear me say this. Over this past year and a half, I can't lift the depression my wife has had. I can't lift the days that I don't feel like praying. I can't lift. All I can do is go back to the word and say, "God, what did you say?" He said, "I'll send you an advocate, a helper, the Holy Spirit." In the Greek, it's called the paraclete or parakletos, which means the one who comes alongside to help you. So when I get up every Sunday morning knowing hundreds of thousands of people are going to watch me preach a message, I say, "God, I can't lift this pressure on my own. Holy Spirit, I need you." And at that moment when I call the Holy Spirit, I don't even have to look up. But somebody greater than me, stronger than me, y'all better help me in this place, brings me to a place that I couldn't get to on my own. And they say, "Father, I can't lift it, but through Christ, through what God has done for me, through what you continue to do, I can lift the pressures of life." Somebody at Lakewood needs to know that Jesus has sent you an advocate to help you lift and have peace under pressure. I can make us hype for the rest of this time. I don't want you hype. I want you to know where your help comes from. Every morning I wake up, I ask for my helper. And many of you have been trying to live life without your help. If somebody was playing a game with you and they gave you an advantage, why wouldn't you take it? Why, if they gave you 10 points, I don't know who you play games with. If somebody's giving me 10 points, I'm taking all the points and I'm gonna try to run the score up. You hear what I'm saying? If you are a believer in Jesus Christ, when you put your faith in him, you got an advantage. And his name is the Holy Spirit. You want peace in the storm? Call on the Holy Spirit. You want to be able to be calm and not slap those people? Call on the Holy Spirit. And the disciples, they wasn't really feeling that. They were like, "Jesus, we would rather have you." And he said, "You don't even know what you need. Because you think you would rather have more money, but the Holy Spirit will lead you and guide you in places that you don't even know what you need to do right now." Do y'all know? I lead a multi-million dollar organization and I preach to all kinds of people all over the world. I have a 6-month high quality Tulsa Community College education. Top shelf, premium. Never been to business school, never been to seminary, but I have an advocate who stands outside of time and says, "Michael, when you're moving, go this way and go that way and say this and shut up and move now and go here." And every day I wake up, I have a meeting with the one who lives inside of me. And if you are out here trying to lift the pressures of life on your own, you are losing while you think you're winning. If you want peace, go to the one who has given you an advocate to help you lift every single situation in your life. I'm gonna help you. Because some of y'all are pushing God away in the time you need him most. When the pressure is on, when the weight is heavy, That's when you call the Holy Spirit. 1 Peter 5:7. It says, give all your worries and cares to God, for he cares about you. If you don't know who the advocate is, look at John 14:26. It says, but when the Father sends the advocate as my representative, this is Jesus talking. In case you didn't know, that is the Holy Spirit. He will teach you everything and will remind you of everything I have told you. I want you to see how powerful the Holy Spirit is. He'll teach you stuff you don't know. And he'll remind you of stuff that you didn't know you even put in you. I truly believe this. I don't have to remember every scripture. All I have to do is get it in me. Because if I just get it in me, the Holy Spirit has something to pull on. I can't tell you how many times I've walked into meetings or walked onto stages and I said, Holy Spirit, I don't know what to do. I've never been here before. He said, but I have. And he tells me, because you put it in, I can pull it out of you. And there's some of us that are getting weighed down by the pressures and you're not putting in what you need to put in so the Holy Spirit can draw out of you in the time that you need it. Practically, the Holy Spirit is my best friend. And some of y'all are like, I don't know about this. I'm just trying to tell you, if you want practical peace, as you walk out of here, you're going to call on the Holy Spirit. So what do you want us to do? One simple point. I want you to pursue peace. Pursue it. See, the problem with most of us is most of us will not pursue the thing that we desperately need and want. And if you're going to pursue peace, it's only found in the Holy Spirit. Pastor Mike, make it real practical for us. Okay, when you get saved, I want you to write this down because this changed everything for me. When you get saved, that salvation gives you the peace with God. So all your past sins, everything is settled at salvation. I get peace with God. But when you abide in him, when you read your word, when you stay in a small group, when you keep coming to church, when you abide, it gives you the peace of God. See, I get peace with God from all my past sins and everything that I would do in the future. But when I start staying connected to God and have accountability in my life, and when I'm about to slip up on that website, I call my brother and say, man, I was about to mess up. You are abiding in him and you get peace of God. And now watch this. But when you start pursuing peace, pursuit produces peace like God. I want you to hear what I just said. Salvation gives you peace with God. Abiding in him gives you the peace of God, but pursuit produces the peace like God. That's why Philippians 1 and 2 says, may God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ give you grace and peace. These are the two things that every man and woman needs. They need grace and they need peace in their life. Romans 5:1. I'm just giving you scripture because I want to bring this thing all the way home. It says, therefore, since we have been made right with God by the sight of faith, we have peace with God because of what Jesus Christ our Lord has done for us. Okay? Then you go to Isaiah 26:3. You will keep in perfect, everybody say peace. All who trust in you and whose thoughts are fixed on you. See, some of y'all are thinking about the wrong things. If you would just get your thoughts focused on God, you would get the peace of God. John 14:27 says, I'm leaving you with the gift, peace of mind and heart. And the peace I will give, the world cannot give, and it cannot take it away. Pastor Mike, you came to the last night of Hope and Life Conference just to tell us that we need peace? Yeah. But you can't get it by yourself. You need to use the Holy Spirit. So tomorrow, when you're frustrated and everything's not going your way and the woman closes the door to your plane, in your face, the first person you should call is not your bestie. The first thing you should do is not go to Facebook and start sending subliminal messages. There's an airline I can't stand and it starts with AA. I'm trying to help somebody practically because you have been robbed of peace and it's stealing your character. People don't trust you no more, because when you don't have peace, you do stupid stuff. And when you start doing stupid stuff, then you'd be like, that really wasn't me. And God is saying, I have a better way for you to walk this life out. And it's calling on your advocate, the Holy Spirit. So tomorrow, you're going to walk up and you're going to say, Holy Spirit, I need you, because today I'm going to face pressures that I don't know about. So I am about to lift this stuff with your help. You ready, Holy Spirit? One, two, three. Let's go. That was easy. Why is it easy? It's easy because I feel it, but I'm not lifting it. What God is saying, I don't ever want you to walk alone again. I don't ever want you to lift the pressures of infertility by yourself again. I don't want you to lift that addiction you have by yourself ever again. I don't want you to ever feel lonely and try to lift it by yourself again. I'll never put more weight on you than you can bear. Not alone, but with the help of the Holy Spirit. I hope you never forget me sitting in this very vulnerable position on this stage, because this is you in your life every day. I got a bigger contract in front of me than I've ever had. I've never seen anything like this. Nobody from my family ever finished high school, and now I'm walking into this. It's okay when you have the Holy Spirit on your side, because he will give you peace that passes all understanding. It does not make sense that with the pressure of life that I'm facing today, that I can still come up here and minister to you. My wife called me right before I came out here and she said, babe, MJ's having a hard day today. She said, I really hate when you're gone. I just really need peace right now. And we prayed in the back of this place. And I felt the heavy burden of guilt that I was feeling for being gone, and frustration of like, God, why would this be happening? And I prayed, and it felt heavy at the moment. But as I called on the Holy Spirit, he said, I make what's heavy so very light when you allow me to lift and give you peace under pressure. Now watch this. When you walk in a relationship and knowing how strong the Holy Spirit is, I'm working harder than I even have to. I'm now taking my hands off of it. Oh, you don't see me. I got one finger on the thing that I couldn't lift by myself. But the Holy Spirit has come to make what is heavy light. I need somebody in Lakewood to hear me, that you don't have to walk through it carrying the weight of life, but the Holy Spirit will make what is heavy so light. Stay standing all over this building. I wanted to preach something different, and the Holy Spirit told me, he said, don't do it, because there's somebody in this room who was about to buckle under the pressure. And they've been trying to plan their way out of the pressure. I'm coming. But why in the world would you have help and not use it? If you're a believer in this place and you don't take advantage of the Holy Spirit, it's like having a bank account with $1 million in it and you walking around not eating food because you won't go to the ATM and pull the money out. You have power, but you haven't tapped in. And today at a young adult conference where it would be better if we got hype, I want to give you hope and life. That if you're going to make it through this life, you need the power of the Holy Spirit. Will somebody make some noise in this building if you are going to have peace under pressure? Nick, I hope this is okay. If you're in this room, I don't even know if we're supposed to do an altar call or anything, but I think there's some faith that needs to be stirred in this place. If you're in this room and you've been under any type of pressure, pressure as a mom, pressure as a young person, I'm not trying to make you come up here. This got to be real for you. The Holy Spirit said that he was about to become real to people in this room tonight. And you're saying, I don't want no spooky stuff. It ain't going to be spooky. It's going to be power. In the name of this conference, peace is power. The only way that we get peace. Do y'all know that it's the fruit of the love, joy, peace. Like, we say this stuff all the time, but then we don't understand how it practically works in our life. If you want peace, you gotta get it from the Holy Spirit. So today, if you are buckling under any type of pressure, I could call out all kinds of stuff, but I believe there's people in here whose school has you tripping right now and ready to give up. That's why people would rather commit suicide and slice and cut, because they don't want to lift the pressure of life. But the Holy Spirit is saying, if you just ask me, I'll come in and I'll lift it. And what you want is the Holy Spirit to knock the door down. You want to, boom, I am the Holy Spirit. I have come to now deliver you from everything that you're going through. He doesn't do that because the Holy Spirit is a gentleman. He only comes where he's invited. So all I'm asking you today, my sister already coming, there's people already coming. If you want to invite the Holy Spirit in, anew and afresh to your life, I want you to make your way to this altar. I don't care. There's going to be a lot of people up there. How bad do you want what God has for you? I don't want nobody to see me. It does not matter who sees you. Do not be cute in this moment. I want everybody that wants to make a step of faith. And I know there's people in here and you're thinking logistically right now. Like, I think that's everybody. I think everybody got to move. So I'm going to just stay right here and then God will meet me right here. The problem with that is that faith is an action word. Faith without works is. So even a step towards this altar is you saying, Holy Spirit, I want you to come in a brand new way in my life.